Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
It's a pleasure to meet you.
And you.
Okay, so let's start from the beginning.
Yeah.
When did you start writing books, and also which are your major influences as a writer?
Okay. I didn't write really until quite late. I was at university. We tended to devise plays as a group. You know, no one really was allowed to go away and write them. You had to argue and work out what the production was altogether. So I always thought there was something quite. I didn't quite have the confidence to write something by myself and say to the group, this is what we're going to do. So I didn't write anything at university. And also, at university, I wouldn't really have had anything to write about. You know, there's no real experience that needed to be written down. But I acted a lot at university, and I decided that that was what I wanted to do professionally. So throughout my 20s, I worked on and off, mainly off as an actor in various theatres. Mm-hmm. And as time went on, I realized that I was never really going to make any mark as an actor. I wasn't a very good actor. I loved plays and I loved stories and I loved movies and I loved television drama, but I didn't have any particular talent. And I used to, if I was in a rehearsal room, I used to realize that it was the writer who had the best job. Mm-hmm. So gradually, when I was about 26, 27, I started writing a comedy, television comedy, a sitcom, about waiters. When I wasn't working as an actor, I worked as a waiter in lots of terrible restaurants. And I thought there was something quite funny about waiters who wanted to do other things, waiters who wanted to be poets and models and actors and comedians. And I wrote a sitcom about, you know, waiters who want to escape this terrible restaurant. And up until then, the only thing that I'd written were letters. I used to love writing letters to my friends, and a friend of mine who I'd written to a lot was a television producer, and she read the script and showed it to someone at the BBC, and they paid me, you know, £200, a tiny amount for the script. And that was a huge change for me, to be paid to write something. It felt like a real landmark, and I realized that no one wanted to see me act, but people were interested in writing. So I gave up acting and began writing again in my spare time. Thank you very much. Thank you. That's great. But the main while I was still acting, I was reading a lot of scripts for theatres. Theatres get lots of submissions from amateur writers, you know, for plays to put on. Mm-hmm. And I was reading a lot of these, and starting to work with other playwrights and other writers on their projects. And I was offered a job doing that full time for the BBC, reading everything that came in from all the amateur writers in the country. And so I read thousands and thousands of scripts, and learned a great deal from that. Sorry, this is my life story. I hope this isn't boring. Anyway, I would be more precise. Another friend of mine who was a theatre director, a guy called Matthew Warchus, he had seen a play by Sam Shepard. I don't know if you know Sam Shepard, a great American playwright. And he thought this play would make a good film. And I'd seen a lot more films than my friend, and so he thought that because I had a typewriter and I'd watched a lot of films, that I'd know how to write a movie. So we started writing a movie script together. So I was writing a comedy, I was writing a movie script based on the Sam Shepard play called Simpatico, and suddenly, very quickly, the movie script got made. With, you know, Sharon Stone and Jeff Bridges and all these amazing actors. And so suddenly I, almost by accident, because of my friend's encouragement, I had a produced screenplay. So I was very, very, very lucky. I think most writers spend years and years and years working on their style and a voice, and they write, you know, something which they absolutely have to say. But my journey into it was through acting, was through script editing, was through collaborating with friends. So it was a very strange journey into writing.
And all those things helped to get you to this point, right?
Yeah, I think so. I think acting, you know, as an actor, I only ever played tiny parts, you know, I rarely spoke. But I used to sit in rehearsals and watch people perform. Brilliant actors, you know, Judi Dench and all these incredible actors perform Chekhov and Shakespeare and Stoppard and Pinter and Osborne, you know, great modern and classical playwrights. And I think, you know, I just absorbed what makes a good scene, what makes good dialogue, what actors like to perform. You know, when I write scripts now, I hate the idea that the actors might not enjoy it. So I feel an obligation that they should, you know, have pleasure from a scene. So it did help, though, you know, it was 8 years of having no money and worrying and not really feeling confident about writing before I actually, you know, made a living from it. And influences.
Oh yes.
Influences. I mean, there's so many. You know, in British theatre, I was grew up really loving a lot of British playwrights of the 50s and 60s, like Harold Pinter, John Osborne, Tom Stoppard. In cinema, I've always loved a kind of classic style of American comedy, particularly from the 1930s, films like Bringing Up Baby and The Philadelphia Story and The Lady Eve, films by Billy Wilder and Lubitsch and Frank Capra and a sort of a later school of American comedy, Woody Allen. You know, Woody Allen is my main influence, I think. My great hero.
Yes.
The films that he made in the 70s and the 80s in particular. And in literature, you know, I grew up with that very classic collection of works, and you know, Austen, the Brontes, Dickens, Thomas Hardy, you know, 19th century English literature. I there's hardly any influence in the books I've written. I mean, there's nothing that's like Jane Austen, there's nothing that's like Emily Bronte, but I think if you grow up studying literature and loving literature in Britain, you can't escape the influence of Dickens or Hardy. So that very classic school of English literature is something which I grew up loving. But as a writer, my main influence, I suppose, is a school of American 20th century literature. Salinger and Fitzgerald and Philip Roth. You know, there are bits in my novels that are stolen from Goodbye Columbus, Catcher in the Rye, or Franny and Zooey, you know, that are very much influenced by a kind of late 20th century American school, which I there's something about that period in American literature that was so exciting and so central to the culture and so influential. I think those American writers, Cheever, Carver, Updike, Roth, you know, had an influence that British literature of the same period didn't really have.
Okay. The next question. What makes a qualified writer, in your opinion? Do you believe that the ability to write is something that you are born with, or is something that you can gradually develop through practice and time?
Yeah. I think it's a very difficult question. I never studied creative writing, so I don't know. I think the general opinion on creative writing, on studying writing, seems to be that you know, that it can make a good writer better, but that it can't make a writer, and can't create an actual writer. I'm not sure. I've never really worked with a lot of creative writing students. Certainly that, I think, is the case with acting. You know, I studied really hard as an actor, and there was a kind of certain quality of, you know, charisma, whether you call it charisma or talent, that I just didn't have. And I wonder if the same applies to writing, that there's a kind of natural flair. I haven't read a lot of new writers, so it's hard to say. But I suppose to go back to the first part of the question, what makes a professional writer, I think in a very interesting way that has changed since I began as a novelist. When I started writing, a professional writer was someone who'd had their play performed or their screenplay produced or their novel published. And now a great deal of really good writing is on the internet and is not necessarily paid for by anyone, mm-hmm. but is still really fine writing. So I think the internet revolution, the rise of e-publishing and self-publishing, has changed the definition of what makes a writer. Some people, you know, who have got very frustrated and not getting access to agents or publishers are doing it themselves, in the same way that a lot of filmmakers who can't get their movies made by Hollywood or the BBC, mm-hmm. you know, have picked up a camera and made their own films. And of course I would say that they are filmmakers. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a harder thing to define. Perhaps, mm-hmm. you know, if you defined it as someone who makes their living from writing, that gets harder and harder, even for people who considered themselves to be professional writers. It's very hard now to because of the changing nature of publishing, to make a living, much harder than it was 10 or 15 years ago. But the second part of your question, I think the main requirement, and this is the only thing I know for sure, is you have to read. You know, you have to read and read and read and read every available minute. You have to absorb it. You know, it's fuel for a writer. No one could sit down and write a great novel without ever having read a novel. And the same applies to screenplays. It's not a gene. You know, it's not something you're born with. It's something you have to really work at. And so I think certainly the two main requirements for a writer are to read as much as possible and to have a passion for books and to actually do the writing. You know, often people say, I've got a great idea for a novel, but I can't find the time to put it down, but it's all in my head. Well, it isn't in your head. It isn't in your head. The act of writing it down will change the nature of the novel. What you have in your head is an anecdote. When you write it down and try and find the words and try and express what's in your head, that's when you become a writer.
Okay. So, can everyone write? What do you believe?
I think not everyone has a natural sense of story or character. I think that's the hard thing. I think you can learn grammar, you can widen your vocabulary, you can pick up things from other writers, but. Some people are more imaginative than others. Some people have a greater facility with language and with dialogue than other people, I think. Again, I don't know, are you all studying creative writing as well? Are you writing stories and plays? And,
No.
I think I'd be able to answer the question better if I worked a lot with students. But.
Okay. So, in your novels, you focus on human relations.
Yeah.
How does this affect the pace of your narratives or shape up the structure of your stories?
It's an interesting question. I've just written, the thing I've written most recently is a love story for television, a two-part love story. About two people who meet on a train and on the morning journey to work. And I know when people watch it and they see the first conversation between these two people that they will know that they're going to fall in love. You know, that finding surprises in a love story is very hard. There's a kind of shape to a love story. There's a kind of predictability mm-hmm. to a love story that is very, very hard to overcome. You know, there are all kinds of cliches in love stories. You know, that A is going to be married to B and hates C, who's going to be married to D. Now, the predictable love story is that A will fall in love with C. Do you know what I mean? I mean, it's the great cliche of love stories is people who hate each other falling in love with each other. It's mm-hmm. the plot of Much Ado About Nothing, it's the plot of Pride and Prejudice, it's the plot of Annie Hall, it's the plot of When Harry Met Sally, it's the plot of The Philadelphia Story, it's the plot of The Apartment, it's the plot of every great love story, that A is with B, but should be with C, C is with D, but that's should be with, you know, you know, it's very predictable. So within that, you have, you know, I don't read Pride and Prejudice and think, oh, it's so predictable. Do you know what I mean? I mean, I don't think, oh, she's going to end up with Darcy. So you have to find pleasures along the way. You have to find twists and turns. You have to find, classically, you know, you have to find obstacles. And I think the challenge for the writer of a modern love story is finding obstacles, because in the past obstacles were class or race. You know, they were to do with the inappropriateness of the relationship. That someone poor wanted to be with someone rich. That I'm adapting Thomas Hardy's Far From the Madding Crowd at the moment, and I've previously adapted Tess. And those love stories, class is crucial. A can't be with B because A is a milkmaid, or B is a shepherd. So in a modern world, those divisions are still there, but they're less critical. So in One Day, Emma and Dexter are from different classes, but you know, if they were really in love, they could still get together. So you have to find different obstacles. I think that's the challenge for the writer of a modern love story, is to keep it interesting, to avoid cliches, and to find new obstacles all the time.
Okay. So my question is a bit more personal.
Okay.
How did you feel when they first told you that they were going to make your books a movie, and when you saw that these movies are a great success?
Yeah.
And, spice things about the experience, please.
Okay, the experience of, well, you know, it's a good experience usually. I think it's, I've done it, I've written three books and two of them have been made into films, and when my first book, in English it's called Starter for 10, which is a catchphrase from a quiz show, so it doesn't really make sense, but when we made that into a film, when the film was finished, I wasn't really happy with it, because the book was written in the first person, so you were in his head, and all the good jokes were in the character's head, and when you put that on screen, you lose all the best jokes. You know, a lot of the jokes in the book came from the fact that he thought he was being cool, and he was telling the reader that he was being cool, but the reader could tell that the opposite was true. When you put that on screen, you only get the uncool bit. You only get the failures. You don't get the delusions. So you lose a lot of irony, you lose a lot of jokes. And I wrote the script for that, and I found it very hard to get the character's voice onto the screen. And the great strength of the great strength of the book was this character's voice. And so when the film was finished, I wasn't really happy with it, because there was a whole political element that was missing. There were lots of scenes that were really funny in the book that weren't funny in the film, and it was tough. But I look back at that film now, and I'm really fond of it. It has the most amazing cast, you know, James McAvoy and Rebecca Hall and Benedict Cumberbatch and all these actors who've gone on to be quite famous and go off and make superhero movies. But at the time, they were all new and fresh, and it's a brilliant cast, and I quite like that film. And I like One Day as well, but I think... One Day was very, the novel was very personal to me, not autobiographical, but very personal, and I was so attached to it, I couldn't bear the idea of someone else writing the script, so I wrote the script, and the script was much longer than the finished film, and I like the film very much, and I like the actors in it very much, but the version in my head is about 4 hours long. You know, that's the hard thing. You know, you have to lose so much, and I regret a lot of the things that either I couldn't transfer from the book or I couldn't make work on screen. So that's always the problem. If it were to happen again, I would let someone else write the script, because you have to be so cruel, you have to be so tough, and I wasn't able to be inventive and original enough with the material to write the right kind of script. So, this is a very long answer. The thing which I always keep hold of is that when you make a film of a book, the book doesn't cease to exist. You know, the book is always there, and the experience of reading a book and watching a film are very, very different. A film can never be a book read aloud. You know, it always has to be its own thing. So I don't always think that fidelity is a good thing in filmmaking. I think often books which make quite bold, brave changes to the original story that are necessary are better for it. Mm-hmm. I think if you get a book and you just copy out the dialogue, you know, like this, you'll have a really boring film. Mm.
That's funny, that was my question.
Okay.
You answered it. So,
okay. But I could say more. You were going to ask about...
Yes, I was going to ask you, first of all, how long does it take you to do the adaptation of the book?
Well, you think it would be quick. You think, you know, it's all in your head and I can, you know, recite the dialogue. But it took much longer to write the script than it did to write the book. Much longer. You know, you write 20, 30 drafts. You write endless drafts. And it's very, very hard to capture a character's inner process, inner thoughts, inner feelings on screen. You know, you have to rely on actors, and usually I've worked with really great actors, and a lot of actors have improved my writing. But then sometimes there are things that you can't quite get onto the screen. But the process is very long, and it's very, very, very stressful. It's very stressful.
But how do you choose what elements to leave out?
Well, I think you have to often to read a book. Maybe to read one day maybe takes 10 hours, and often a chapter in the book is there only because it's funny, or it's only because it's an amusing anecdote, or it's an interesting character point. When you put something on the screen, everything costs money. Everything costs money, and you have 20 people who sit down and read your script, and they will look at every line, and they say, "Do we need this? Do we need this? Do we need this?" So, in screenwriting, there's an emphasis on story. Constantly changing, constantly moving things forward, and you can't have a 10 or 15 minute scene that's just there to show a character. You can't have a 10 or 15 minute scene that's just there because it's got a good joke in it. Everything has to earn itself. You know, if I sit down in a book and I write, "It starts to rain," then, you know, it starts to rain. There's four words. If I write "It starts to rain" in the screenplay, they have to hire these massive, this massive rig. They have to shoot at night because rain doesn't show up if you shoot it in the day. They have to, which means that they have to lose a day shooting the day before and a day shooting the day after. They have to buy 10 different copies of the actors' costumes, so that when they get wet and they do a retake, they just can go and put on dry versions, because you can't dry it with a hairdryer. They just have to put the same costume on again. So if I write "It starts to rain" in a screenplay, it costs £30,000, and it's not my £30,000; it's someone else's £30,000. So the person who's writing the check for the rain machine will say to me, "Does it have to rain?" And my job as a screenwriter is to say, "Yes, it does have to rain." But often you think, "Oh, I don't know, does it have to rain?" And you cross out the words "it starts to rain" and someone is £30,000 better off, but the film isn't so good. So that is the constant debate in filmmaking. I'm sorry if I will repeat all this later, but you know, someone said that filmmaking was turning money into light, and it is a bit like that. If I write a book, if I want my book to be 330 pages long, it doesn't make any difference to the publisher if it's 330 pages or 320 pages. I mean, it makes a tiny difference. But to make a film that's 2.25 hours long instead of 2 hours long is millions and millions of pounds. Millions of pounds. And that all starts with words on the page. And that's a terrifying responsibility. And that's why I really enjoy filmmaking, but I find it absolutely heart-stoppingly scary and stressful. So even, you know, if your script doesn't get made, part of you thinks, damn, I really wanted them to make that script. And part of you thinks, oh, thank God. Thank God I don't have to worry about it. But then, of course, you know, you only write things to have them made. But it's very stressful.
Then writing for the big screen is not really such a magical process. Novel writing.
It is less personal, it's more impersonal. In that, I think it's really hard to sit down and write a novel for 1 or 2 or 3 years and not put a lot of yourself into it. You know, you can't write things that you haven't thought or felt. And in that sense, unless you're writing science fiction or detective stories, all fiction is autobiographical because it's all a reflection of who you are. But, you know, I can write exterior space station, the spaceship explodes and scattering bodies throughout the galaxy, and it's nothing to do with me. You know, it's entirely objective. And there's something about screenwriting that's very structural. Structure is very important. It's very technical in that you're writing often in a certain genre, so you have to hit certain story points at certain times. To finish a book and think, oh, that book had a strange ending, is not a bad experience. To walk out of a cinema and think, oh, that film had a strange ending, is a more difficult proposition for a film production company. You know, there's a greater fear of ambiguity, sadness, melancholy. You can't make a $20 million melancholy film. So all of those things are make it a very different process and a less personal one. It's also, it's collaborative, you know, it's a, mm-hmm. and it involves lots of fighting.
Okay, so in your book, One Day, you use a very unique structure.
Yes.
You describe one day each year, instead of narrating the 20 years of the character's life. So how did you come up with this narrative?
Well, I think it was partly because I'd written a lot of on television in particular, I'd written a lot of love stories. And love stories, as I was saying earlier, you know, often contain a lot of cliches. Mm-hmm. And if people were to tell the story of their own love affair or their own marriage or their own life, they would hit certain beats, they would hit certain moments. They'd, you know, first meeting, the first date, the first sexual encounter, the first kiss, the first sexual encounter, the first, you know, the marriage proposal, the wedding, the birth of a child, the divorce, you know, that there would be certain key moments.
Yes.
And I wanted to write a big love story that told the story of a relationship from beginning to end, but that didn't have any of those in. You know, didn't have any of those cliches. And I thought, wouldn't it be interesting not to show the character's wedding, but to show how they were getting on 3 months afterwards? Wouldn't it be great not to show another, you know, maternity room scene, push, push, and the baby being lifted up, but to show how that feels 6 months after? And wouldn't it be great to show, you know, to show a wedding and then for the twist to be that it's the wedding of someone else, and you know that you'd have, and not to show the first kiss, but to show, you know, 3 hours after the first kiss. So it was a way of avoiding cliches. If you told someone the story of one day, they'd say, "Oh, well, that sounds like When Harry Met Sally, or The Way We Were, or you know, any number of films." But because you're always off to the side of the main events, it somehow feels less familiar. And I think it also had something to do with me being a screenwriter before I was a novelist, in that I like to think in terms of, you know, you have these boxes and you decide what to fill them with, which isn't necessarily the way that a lot of people write fiction. So I like the idea, it was like a puzzle, you know, you have 20 boxes, what can you put in those 20 boxes that will tell the whole story, but will stick to the structure? And the hard thing for me is, you know, that whatever the book is like, whatever people feel about the book, it's a really good idea. And it's the only original idea I will ever have, because I didn't think anyone, I did, as far as I could tell, no one had ever done it before. And so I was, all the time I was writing it, I was thinking, God, I hope someone else doesn't have this idea. it's the only original thing I will ever come up with. So that was another reason that it seemed like a good idea.
did that structure made the turning of the book to a movie, the script, was it easier or harder? Or was
very
it the
hard.
Same?
It was very hard, because in a book you have a narrative voice. You have a narrator who can say, quite simply in prose, 3 months ago they bumped into each other on Tottenham Court Road. 6 months before, Emma had given birth to whatever. You can actually, Emma doesn't have a child, so you could, but 6 months before they had got married. You know, you can just tell people. You can show people at the top of a chapter that it's the same day. You just tell the reader it's the same day. On screen, you don't have that kind of narrator. The difficulty on screen was both to convey to the audience that it was the same day, which in the end we did in the most obvious way, just by putting a caption, but also to justify showing that particular event. You know, why aren't we seeing Emma and Dexter's wedding? Why aren't we seeing their first kiss? Why aren't we seeing how Emma and Ian met? And that was tricky. So it doesn't. It was the hard thing was that it's primarily a literary conceit, and not really a filmic conceit. In a film, you're always thinking, well, no, show me the most. Don't show me this. Show me the most important thing. Show me the thing that's most crucial to the story. And often that happens off screen. So it's difficult.
Do you feel that your style of writing has changed much since you first began?
Yes, I think when I first began, I was very stuck to comedy, and I think writing in a sort of situation comedy style and romantic comedy style, and most of my first scripts were largely comic, and I was a bit scared of writing anything purely dramatic. And as I've got older and got more experience, I've been less embarrassed by emotion and by things that are maybe a bit darker or more cynical. And I think I also, when I started writing, I was my first novel was written in the first person, and writing in the first person is not easier, but it's a lot more like acting. You know, you find a character and you find a voice, and as long as you stay in that character, you're fine. You know, it felt to me a bit like improvising, writing in the first person. Writing in the third person, in the past tense, you have no excuses. You can't, you know, the main character in in my first novel, you know, he didn't have much imagination and he was quite a foolish character. So if he says the sun looked like a big fried egg, then it's fine because he's a fool. You know, when you're writing in the third person, if you write the sun looked like a big fried egg, the reader's going to throw the book across the room. So you have no excuses in the quality of your prose. You have no one to hide behind. And I wouldn't have been able to write my first book in the third person. I think it took me a couple of books to find out what I sounded like as a novelist, rather than what the character sounded like. So I think also, you know, the hard thing now, trying to write another book, is I feel like there are certain areas of, I don't want to repeat myself, and there are certain things that I feel less confident in writing about. When I started writing, I wrote a lot about characters in their 20s. And now, because that feels like such a long time ago, I feel less confident about writing youthful love. You know, I'm sure that it feels the same, and I remember how it feels, but I haven't been on a date for 20 years, so I don't feel as inclined to write about it. I was going to say I think I've got better, but then sometimes it's certainly with scripts I think I've got better, because you learn, it's much more of a craft, and you learn your craft. But there are things in my first book that I wish I could do now. There was a kind of lightheartedness and a kind of playfulness that I don't think I can do now. But for the most part, it's I've learned, I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So in the end, what is your advice for aspiring writers?
There's three things. So I'm repeating myself, but you really need to read and read and read.
Okay.
And to read widely. Mm-hmm. You know, to read the books you want to write, but also read across genre. You know, read books that you don't necessarily read, you know, high and low.
Mm-hmm.
Read genres that you would never dream of writing, because they still might influence you. Read from, you know, the past, and read current writing, read writing from around the world. That would be the first thing. And, you know, be passionate about books. You know, pay for them and read them at every spare moment. I think that's absolutely the first rule. The next thing is to throw things away. You know, the worst thing that could happen to you is for people to publish the first draft of your first novel. You know, that's absolutely, with very few exceptions, that would be a disaster. Rewriting is really important, and listening to criticism. You know, I often, when I hand in a script, I then have to go to a meeting and everyone tells me what I've done wrong, and it's the thing that I hate more than anything in the world. I really hate it. Then they'll say, you've got to go away and you've got to change this, you've got to change this, and you've got to change this. And when I then go and do that, I'm nearly always grateful. I'm nearly always pleased that I did. So I think listening to advice, rewriting very rarely makes something worse. It nearly always improves something. And that leads to the third thing, which is don't listen to anyone. You know, that you need on certain things, you need to be absolutely sure. You need to be absolutely stubborn, and you need to absolutely listen to your own instincts. All of the regrets half of the regrets I have about things I've written come from me listening to other people, and the other half come from me not listening to other people.
Uh-huh.
And the trick is to know which battles to fight, you know, which principles to stick to. And there are things that I've, you know, I changed in scripts or given up, fights that I've surrendered on, that I you know, I still now wake up at 4 a.m. and regret. And there are other things which I was absolutely stubborn and unfixable on, and I was wrong. So There's no answer. That's not really advice because there's no way of knowing. But the main thing, I'm repeating myself, but not just reading, watching. You know, I watch 3 or 4 or 5 films every week, and I love it. I do it because I love it, but I do it because also that's how you absorb things. There's a lot of personal experience in books, but I could also go through page by page and say, that's from Annie Hall, that's from Great Expectations, that's from Philip Marlowe, that's from Jane Austen, you know, that's from Charlie Chaplin, that's from, you know, that everything is stolen. And so if you don't absorb as much as you can, then you won't be able to produce. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.